Thank you. During our opening song, I want to encourage you to clear your minds of the worries and outside activities of the day, to center your thoughts, and to focus your hearts on memories of Matisse. Following the song, Pastor Craig Heselton will lead us through the rest of our service. Thank you.
Good morning. I'd like to welcome each one of you as we gather today to remember and celebrate the life of Matisse Kivi Kevelinks, who was tragically and suddenly taken from us just over a week ago on July 4th, 2021. What a remarkable young man he was. Please join me as we begin our service in a moment of prayer. Heavenly Father, we invite you into this room with your presence, with the presence of Jesus, with the presence of the Holy Spirit, to come and to comfort, to come and to remind us, to come and speak to each one of us about the unique impact that Kivi had on our lives. Lord, as we enter into this place of grief, into this place of mourning, we know that we enter in knowing that you are there. That you are there waiting to receive us, waiting to encourage us, waiting to lift us up. And so I invite you to do that this morning, Lord. Be in this place. Shine your light in the midst of darkness. Cause us to hear your voice whispering words of comfort to us as we remember. We give this day to you. We give Kivi to you. We ask that you would be with us. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. For me, the only way to deal with a tragedy such as this is to turn to the Bible, to turn to God, and to see what the Bible tells us about the kind of God that we have, what he's like, that he's a loving and a compassionate God. So please listen as I read just a couple few brief scriptures out of the Bible. The first one is in Psalm 103, verses 13 through 22, and here's what it says. It says, as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are but dust. As for man, his days are like grass. He flourishes like a flower in the field. The wind blows over it, and it is gone. And its place remembers it no more. In Psalm 68, verses 19 and 20 in the Message Bible, it says, blessed be the Lord. Day after day, he carries us along. He is our Savior, our God. Oh, yes. He's God for us. He's God who saves us. Lord God knows all deaths, ins and outs. And then in Psalm 147, verses 3 and 5, it says, he heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He determines the number of the stars and calls each of them by name. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. His understanding has no limits. As we continue our time this morning, I'd like to invite a few people up to share some memories and words of encouragement about Kiwi. I'd like to, first of all, invite Brad Larson, the coach of the Columbus Blue Jackets.
So, first of all, awesome to see this many people here. I always make my wife nervous. She was asking me this morning about, could you write something down? No, I didn't. There's a man in the room that always said, you speak from the heart. It rhymes with Cinderella. And the first part is Tor, so if you can't figure that out, come to me and I'll share. I don't want to embarrass the man, but so I think it's always best just to speak from the heart. About 2.5 weeks ago, I was going through the room and I saw Kivi, and how you doing, Kivi? Big smile, right? I think everybody can agree with that, that the one thing that you always saw on his face was this huge grin. And there's more meaning behind that grin, and I'll get to that in a little bit here. But so obviously, July 4th, that night, getting that call was very tough, and my heart just sank. I went to the family right away, thinking of Kivi right away, and then thinking of all the people that knew him so well in this room. And so, first thought was just, I got to get there. And so I'm trying to think, what are you going to say? And quickly reminded, there's nothing you can't say. So it's just to be present. Get there and be present. So I got there, and there was lots of tears, lots of hugs, lots of comforting, lots of grieving. And I'm going to refer to my wife again. She says one of the best qualities you can have is to be a good listener. And I am still learning that quality every day. I certainly have not mastered that. But for the next 2.5 days, I just sat there and I listened. Because I didn't know him nearly as well as me. his teammates. So I just listened. And what I heard was really impressive for the family. I hope you translate this for them. I don't speak very good Latvian. He exuded humility. He was selfless. He was a man of integrity. And one thing, I think the second night we're sitting around and we were talking about, apparently Kivi loved to prank people. He literally spent weeks on the internet studying how do I prank somebody, which brought a whole new meaning to the smile for me, because he was a little bit mischievous behind that smile. So just the art of listening and what I heard about him was, it was awesome. And to the family, I'll say this, he's inspired a country. He's inspired a young generation of goalies. He's impacted, gosh. He's impacted so many people. So, in closing, just I want to thank the family. For sharing Kivi with the whole Blue Jackets family. Thank you so much, because he truly, truly was a gift. And the last thing I'll say is, unfortunately, it takes tragedy to remind us to hug your mom, your dad, your kids, your family. All these petty arguments that we have, silly disagreements, just move by them. Hug your kids, hug your wife, hug your family, and love everybody. All right, don't miss on that opportunity, because each day is a gift, it is a blessing. All right, thank you.
I believe the next person is Nate Gerby. Is he here? Good.
All right, I'm going to speak about the first time that I really pull this off. I'm not Lars's size. I'm going to speak about the first time I really met Kivi was in a 3-hour car drive, and what better way to meet someone than that? So just a little story of how our hockey world works is I arrived in Cleveland one game before the All-Star break and was going to head home to Michigan to go see my family. And Billy, our GM at the time, and said, are you going to go see your family? I said, yes. He said, could you drive Kivi to Manny's house? And I remember the first day I got there, I said, who's Kivi? Point which kid's Kivi to me, and I'll take him, you know. So, you know, I get in the car ride with Kivi and spend 3 hours. With many of you know me, I probably asked him 300 questions and got to know him really well. And I remember just, yeah, dropping him off and being so impressed and saying how good of a kid is he. And, you know, as I reflect this week and I reflect with my wife, and, you know, we have 3 rules in our house. And, you know, it's respect, it's good attitude. And it's hard work, isn't it? Isn't that Kivi? You know, he lived those 3 things, and we can do that too. And just with his smile, thank you.
To invite Manny and Elvis home.
Thanks, Lars and Gerbs, showing the courage to come up here and talk. It's
could be one of the hardest things I've ever had to do. On behalf of the family, Batista's mom and dad, sister, his uncle, I want to thank everybody for coming here, the Blue Jackets organization. You guys have got far and beyond taking the family in this terrible situation. Smoother from their flights here to the hotel, setting up this beautiful service for him. He'd be mad. He wouldn't want this. You guys don't know Kibby. He wouldn't want this. He'd want everyone just to have a beer and go on their way. But you guys and the Jackets organization is, you guys gone way overboard. Thank you so much from the family. Players, coaches, thank you guys for coming in, leaving your summer homes, and sharing from Columbus here, and Cleveland players, thank you guys. It's a tough situation. We have people who flew in from Minnesota. Thank you for coming. That's where Kibby, when he first got over here to the U.S., spent most of his time in Minnesota. Friends from Michigan who drove down. Love you guys. You made Kibby feel at home. Made it his second home. Michigan was his second home. I know a lot of you guys don't know, but ever since Kibby joined our organization, he would come up and live with my wife and I. Every summer. And he became a son to us. He lived with us through the pandemic. Voter, we quarantined 2 weeks before he came up. You know, so. And I got to play golf with him every day in the summer. Got to hang out with him, play cards. Lars, there's a reason he had the Joker on his mask. He had that smile that he was gonna get you. You know, he's gonna get you. You know, he got to become one of my family. Got to be my brother to my daughter and my son. A great friend to our nephew. He wanted to come to that wedding on July 4th. Got to be good, best friends with Elvis. I want to thank Matisse's mom and dad for raising a beautiful child. Give him to the world for us to share this beautiful angel. You know, he made us so proud. You know, look how many lives you've touched. Matisse, look how many lives you've touched. Torts even flew in, and he hates goalies. You know,
That's the funniest thing that you ever said.
He made us so proud. You made us so proud. On and off the ice, the way you greeted people with a smile, never wanted to be the front of attention. You beat Canada. It was hard for me, but you made us so proud. You made a country proud. I was so happy for you.
He had to shut up.
He had to shut up, yes. If you're gonna push that button, he is also the only goalie to ever beat Canada from Latvia.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But from his first game to being on him, around on the ice with him. Kibby was always, you know, one more drill. Right, Thies? One more drill. Poor Thies had to teach him how to drive, you know. But it was always one more drill. And we'd stretch at center ice, and Kibby would come up after the stretch. We'd been on the ice for almost 2 hours.
And he's like, one more drill. And I'm like, Kivi, I go, you got back-to-back games, and you're probably going to play both of them. He's like, no, one more drill. I said, no, you're getting off the ice. And if everybody knows Kivi, when he doesn't agree with you, he kind of looks at the star. He thinks about it. He doesn't want to agree with you. I thought he was just counting butterflies, but he was just look off into space, and you go, all right. But that was him. I love you. I always will love you. You are my son. You're a great friend to everybody here.
I'm going to try to. Everybody knows I like to talk. I'm going to try to keep it short as possible, but like Lars, I was thinking what to say and to write it down or not. Same thing, you have to speak from the heart. First, when I heard about Matisse Kilimnieks, Latvia, it's really a small country. I was in national team for a training camp, and Coach Carlos came to me and asked me, oh, did you hear rumors about a Latvian goalie is going to be in Columbus Blue Jackets? I never knew who is Matisse Kilimnieks. He came from nowhere, like nowhere. In my head, I was thinking, I have future in Blue Jackets. Who the hell is that guy coming now in my role? I never seen him, never heard his name, and that's when I heard about him, and then I saw that Blue Jackets seriously took him, and I was really worried about that. My first year coming here to Manny's house. So happy that I'm going to Manny's house, and there's this Matisse Kilimnieks living in that house. And I was really worried again. And first our call was, obviously I had to send him the message. I flew in and I told him he was out of in the city. I said, I'm hungry, buy me food. I didn't say, can you? I said, buy me food, because he's younger than me, so I had to be on top of him. I promised to myself that I have to come here and talk to him. It's really tough. Matisse, he wasn't my friend. Matisse was my little brother. Even before the bubble, and I'm sorry, Mikey, Matisse was living with me all the time. He was in my guest room for my wife. He was little brother as well. We played so many board games. He was all about board games. And even now, lately, when he came back from Cleveland, he was living with us as well. And I think Julie figured out that because the hotel room was all the time clean and nobody's living there. He was incredibly educated, really well. I had last two, three days chance to meet his family. His little sister is cute, lovely, she's beautiful. But Matisse was always in mindset that's not your business. He was all the time. He was a good person, lovely person, but he never was talking about other people. He was more thinking about that's not your business, you don't have to know about other people. So he was keeping all the time everything inside, and he was happy with that. I never heard about his family, but now I had a chance to meet. And they are beautiful, really nice family, and now I understand a lot of things from where that education comes. When he came now home, that my wife is pregnant, didn't ask him anything. He was helping more my wife than I am doing. He was doing everything. He was doing dishes. He was cleaning the house. Who does that? Nobody. I'm not doing that. He was helping in everything, and I was appreciative of that. And lately, my wife was worried about our marriage because she was saying that me and Matisse, we had our bromance. I'm happy that in this life, I told him everything what I could. Every single day, I told him that I really love him. I told him that he's my brother, not a friend. And just to tell you guys about the last day, I really believe in destiny, but that was his day. There were 60, 70, 80 people. I never looked for him. I was talking to so many people, and always he came to me. He looked for me. We had our last beer, our last shot, more than one, last cigar. He was always smiling. And I think he made me stronger as a man. I'm gonna have a lot of experience in my life now. I'm having a little baby coming up. He saved not just many lives, but when it happened, I was standing 20, 30 feet back of him. And I was hugging my wife. He saved my son. He saved my wife, and he saved me. My son's second name is going to be Matisse. But except that, if that wasn't me, or my wife or son, that would be 50 other people. He died as hero, and that's not me saying, that was the doctor saying. If he would just sit, wouldn't happen nothing. And as Sabrina said, he saved his last buck. I just wanna that you know that he was a hero. He saved a lot of lives. And I'm pretty sure he did that with a smile, because it's true. That guy, in 2 years that I know him, I never fight with him, never. I hated him in the mornings because when he didn't have his coffee, he was awful person. He was awful, awful. He was slow, like Manny said. You're gonna eat eggs or sandwiches? And he's looking up and looking for answer. Doesn't matter for me. We don't have time, we have to go to practice. Come on, pick it up. He was really slow in that. After a cup of coffee, I was talking to him. He really, like Gerby said, he was really hardworking guy. He, like Manny said, he was trying to be always perfect. But in everything, he was perfect. We were washing his car every second day, and I'm not joking. He was, before the 4th of July, he just bought new shoes, and there were 3 sips of coffee on his shoes. He was trying to clean them. And this was 3 little sips of coffee, drops, sorry. He was all time to be perfect and perfect and perfect. Golf playing with him, you love it, I hate it, because he was doing 5 practice swings and then he was hitting, then he was looking, he didn't like it how he hit it, he was again practice swinging on the same spot when the ball was already in 4. Cleaning his clubs, he was polishing them. I'm gonna miss my brother. I wanna thank, really. I'm happy to be in the best organization in NHL because what you guys did, I can't describe. Come to next day over there to support me and Manny and G and everybody and wife and everybody to organize all this to help his family. That's huge. Players who were in Canada without this thing of quarantine and all that, you flew in. I really appreciate that. And I'm really thankful to you for this help. And like I said, to their family, to little sister especially, I'm honest always. And I learned that from 2 years from Coach Torts, to be straight. So I was straight with little girl and I said to her, I'm not your brother. But I'm your new brother. I'm always gonna be on your side. Whenever ever you need anything, I'm gonna be there for you. And for all of the family. Ever you need any help, I'm gonna be there because I know that he would be there for my mom and for my family. I don't have little sister, I have bigger brother, but I'm gonna be always for you. You can always think that I'm your brother. And I'm gonna love you as my little sister. Thank you again very much for everybody who came. I love you as well.
We have a little video we're gonna show honoring Matisse.
Lennox would tell you right now, he's way ahead of schedule, probably did not expect to be sitting there between the pipes at Madison Square Garden here tonight, but he will get the start, his first NHL start.
Moving in, quick shot to Lennox, outstanding reflexes. The Blue Jackets have won their 5th straight game.
And they pour off the bench to Matisse Kiplenix, his first National Hockey League victory.
Anything you want. Sideways. Honestly, I still can't believe, boys. But, like Cam said, Bjarke, great job. And I honestly couldn't done this without you guys. So thank you.
Shot deflected. Kivenik's down.
Save.
Loose puck in front. And Kivenik quickly grabs that. And the Latvians send it down. And they've beaten Canada for the first time at the World Hockey Championship.
Best player of Team Latvia.
Aston Lismeda is no more.
Number 18, Matisse Kivenik.
Elis viņš liekins translācijā mums teica, ka tos vēl, viņa vēlējums tev ir tas, ko tev arī Kolumbusā treneris teica, tikai nesalaid visu dēlī.
Jā, jā, kā angliski saka, kā šeit.
Jā, labāk neteikt.
Bet jā, jā.
puts it in front. There's a shot. Save made by Kim Lennox. Big save there by Verana. Verana with a shot. Fought off by Kim Lennox. Finding some room. Walks to the net, and Kim Lennox again.
That kid, Kim Lennox, all he does is smile.
Celebrate the life of Matisse Kiv Lennox, affectionately known as Kivi, who was taken from us in a tragic accident on July 4th, 2021, at the young age of 24. He survived by his mother, Astrida, his stepdad, Artis, his sister, Madeira, his uncle, Marius, family, teammates, and coaches, and many friends who loved and knew him. Astrida, it's impossible to imagine the immense pain and grief that you must be feeling right now. We want you to know that all of us in this room and beyond are standing with you and with your family as you walk through this time of deep sadness, as you remember your son. As a pastor, I never had the opportunity to personally meet Kivi, but as a lifelong resident of Columbus and an admitted hockey fan with memories of the Columbus Checkers and the Chill long before the Blue Jackets came to town, I certainly knew of Kivi, having read about him in the papers and seen him play a time or two when he was called up by the CBJ. Columbus is a sports town whose fans love their sports with a loyalty that endures even after their stars retire or no longer with the team. Kivi had just stepped into that place of citywide affection when he was taken from us, and he will be remembered with affection. Born on August 26, 1996, in Riga, Latvia, Kivi put on his first pair of skates at age 3, after watching his cousin play hockey. By age 5, he was a goaltender. By age 10, he announced to his parents that he planned to reach the NHL. After playing for Prizma Riga, the Latvian Hockey Higher League, in 2011-12, he moved to the United States in 2013 to play for the Edina Lakers of the Tier 3 Minnesota Junior Hockey League, and he made the second team All-Star in 2015. He improved and continued to grow and moved up through the system, winning the Anderson Cup with the Tier 1 Sioux City Musketeers in 2016-17, where he was named to the first All-Star team as well as the League Goaltender and Player of the Year award. Kivi played internationally with the Latvia U-17 team in 2013 and the junior team in 2015 and 16, with his team winning the gold medal in 2016. He played for the Latvia senior team in 2018 and 21, and he was in goal, as you saw, for Latvia's first victory over Canada in 2021. Kivi began his career with the Blue Jackets, his professional career in 2017, signing an entry-level contract with the Columbus Blue Jackets, where he was assigned to the Cleveland Monsters of the AHL. Realizing his dream, he was called up by the Columbus Blue Jackets and made his NHL debut with a victory over the New York Rangers on January 19, 2020. And having watched highlights of that victory, he made a few key stops of a person that we all remember with fondness. When asked about his improbable rise from Tier 3 junior hockey to the NHL, something that is somewhat improbable and unheard of, after that first game, Kivi said to one of the reporters, he said, "Honestly, everything is possible. You just have to commit and believe it, honestly. I know it's kind of hard, but if you believe it and work hard and keep doing the right things, everything is possible." Kivi would start 8 games for the Columbus Blue Jackets, winning the last game of this last 2020 season in an overtime victory over the Detroit Red Wings on May 8th, 2021. His mom, Astrida, and dad, Artis, wanted me to express their deep gratitude to the many people who helped Kivi along the way to achieve his dream of playing in the NHL. You've heard it this morning, and I'll say it again, that those who knew Kivi best would tell you that he was always smiling, an approachable kid with a quick laugh, and I learned this morning, ready to do a prank, in a rough and tumble world of hockey. He never took things personally or got upset, even when he was wronged. He was a calm kid with his feet planted firmly on the ground, who knew what he wanted and was willing to fight to be great without putting other people down. Though quiet, Kibbe was a hard-working perfectionist who analyzed everything, whether it be his cars, his clothing, his shoes, who he kept clean, or his goaltending. Elvis's best friend on the team liked to call him the calculator for his ability to quickly compute numbers. You know, he said that quicker than he could do it in his head. He was a calculator. He was smart. I've been told that Kibbe loved sports and games of all kinds, whether it be skiing as a kid, learning how to play golf, video games, cards, and I even heard yesterday about a tradition, Latvian Easter egg fight, where you kind of fight with each other to see who can smash an egg first and the loser has to eat the egg, which was kind of strange. He was always learning new things. He had an appetite for new things. He was what we would call a learner. He loved to learn things, and I found out yesterday that recently he's been watching YouTube videos to learn how to play guitar. Now there's a guy that likes to learn new things. These were the qualities coupled with immense talent that brought Kibbe up the mountain of high expectations and greatness to an NHL career, qualities that also made him a great teammate to many of you. One of the most well-known scriptures in the Bible is found in 1 Corinthians 13, which is a scripture that's all about love. Towards the end of that passage, the author describes the uncertainty of this life, a life filled with unanswered questions, where Paul, the author, writes, "We don't yet see things clearly. We're squinting into a fog, peering through a mist, but it won't be long before the weather clears and the sun shines bright. We'll see it all then, see it all as clearly as God sees us, knowing him directly just as he knows us. But for right now, until that completeness, we have three things to do: trust steadily in God, hope unswervingly, and love extravagantly. But the greatest of these is love." Friends, the reality of this life is that there are things we know and things we don't know. As we try to come to grips with Kibbe's premature death, what are some of the things we know and don't know? First of all, what do we not know? The why questions. Why was such a vibrant, gifted young man with so much potential suddenly taken from us in such a bizarre and tragic way? Perhaps, as Elvis said, it was to save others, but we don't know. Why must a mother say goodbye to her son rather than the other way around, which is the way it ought to be? Having reached the pinnacle of the NHL, why wasn't he allowed to live out the hopes and dreams that he had, his parents had, his coaches and teammates? Or perhaps even the more difficult questions of life. Why is life so unfair, with tragedy seeming to fall on a good person like Kibbe? Or perhaps the deepest question of all, where was God in this tragedy? The passage we read from the Bible tells us that trying to answer these questions is like peering into a fog. We may never understand what went wrong on July 4th or why Kibbe was the victim of this horrific accident. We just can't see things clearly. Understanding the why questions is not possible in this life, no matter how much we want to know. And for each one of us, this is incredibly painful. But even in this unspeakable tragedy, the Bible tells us there are things that we do know. There are things that we know. I'd like to tick off four of them. First of all, we know that God made Kibbe and has known him for all eternity. The words of King David in the Old Testament of the Bible in Psalm 139 could have been said by Kibbe or any person in this room. Here's what David said. He said, "You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know me when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. You created my innermost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be." From this passage, we know God knew Kibbe. And he knew what he would be even before he created the rest of the world. He had him in his mind. He knew what he would be. He knew how he would be formed. He knew what he would be like. He knew all his friends. He knew the days of his life and the impact he would have on all of you before the creation of the world. That's the kind of God we have. We know that Kivi was made by God. God shaped and formed him in his mother's womb with all his physical attributes, his personality, his gifts and talents. We know God knew and loved Kivi as a young man he created. He created in him his own image. He loved him as one made in his own image. And though his life was short, he ensured that Kivi impacted each one of us in unique ways that he designed. Secondly, we can know that God was with Kivi every moment of his life. We already read that he was present with him in the womb, and he witnessed his joyous birth. He walked with him through childhood as he matured into a world-class hockey player. He was present at his death. And he is even with Kivi beyond the grave, beyond the threshold of death. God knows Kivi and has been with him for all eternity, both in the past, before creation, and on into the future, which has no end. We can be sure of this truth. Thirdly, God knows what it's like to lose a son. The God revealed in the Bible is not an aloof God who made everything and then stands back and watches it. He's involved with his creation. He's involved with humanity. The God described in the Bible is present and deeply involved with us. He is unseen, but he's never far away. God demonstrated his love and commitment to us by sending his son Jesus to live among us, to experience what we experience, the joys, the triumphs, the difficulties, and the suffering of this life on earth. God watched as his beloved son was unjustly killed. He watched from heaven as he suffered and died on a cross. He felt his son's pain. God knows what it's like to lose a son. Because of this, we can take our pain, our anguish, and our sorrow to him, because God has suffered this sort of pain firsthand. He can take it. He can take our sadness, our grief, and even our complaints, our questions why that will never be answered. He can take it because he knows what it's like to lose a son. And he stands ready, if we turn to him, to comfort and to love us in our sadness. And finally, fourthly, we can know that this life is not all there is. The passage I read a few minutes ago tells us that there's a day coming when the weather will clear and we'll be able to see things clearly. A day when we can know God in the same way that he knows us. That day is coming beyond the grave when we can have all those unanswerable questions answered. How can each one of us prepare for that day? Most people don't like to think about death or going to a funeral. In particular, young people in the prime of life think they're invincible and would much rather go to a party and have a beer than to attend a funeral. I get it. I was even young once. Yet here we are, grieving the loss of Kivi, a young man taken from us too soon. Mourning a loved one's death forces us to come face to face with our own mortality as we, each one of us, realize that life is short and uncertain. We just don't know the hour or time of our death, a time appointed by God. Kivi's death leads us, each one of us, with a question. Are we ready if our lives were to be suddenly demanded of us? The passage we read earlier gives us three things that we can do right now in this time of grief as we face each of our own futures. Trust steadily in God, hope unswervingly, and love extravagantly. Trust steadily in God. Jesus in the Bible, upon learning that his friend Lazarus had died in the Gospel of John, wept and said to his friend's sister in John 11, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies." The good news of the Bible is that Jesus didn't remain dead after being crucified on a cross. History and the Bible tells us that Jesus rose from the dead and returned to the Father in heaven, where he is alive and engaged in our daily lives, offering relationship and life to those who would put their trust in him. Hope unswervingly, that's a hard word to say. This world is not all there is. Jesus also told us in the Gospel of John in chapter 8, a phrase that probably some of you have seen, like posted on poster board behind the goalie, you know, in hockey rinks or behind the goalposts on football fields. And that is that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. God so loved the world that he gave his only son. Not only did he send him to experience what we experience, but he gave him up on a cross for us so that we might have relationship with him and live eternally with him. Those who put their belief in Jesus will never die. They may pass through the physical death, but they will live forever with God. This life is just a short prelude to what is to come. When you think about eternity, this life, this however many years each one of us has, is like one grain of sand on a seashore in terms of how many years are left. It's a prelude. The Bible further tells us that those who put their faith and belief in Christ will see their loved ones again. This is our hope. We can make ourselves ready today by believing in Christ and personally inviting him into our lives, putting our trust in him. Only then can we be comforted in the deep sadness of the loss of a loved one and move through life not fearing the end of our own lives. Finally, love extravagantly. The scripture we read earlier says that the greatest of these three things is love. The Bible tells us that God is love. We wouldn't know what love was if it wasn't for God. You see, God provides love as the contrast for hate. Hate is the absence of something. Love is something that's active and real. We already read that the Bible tells us that he demonstrated that love by his willingness to die for us on a cross. It's that love that invites us into relationship with him. It's not judgment, it's not hate, it's not anger, it's love. That love walks alongside us in life. And that love is present and ready to comfort us as we grieve when we turn to him. For those of us left behind in Kevi's untimely death, we can best honor him by loving life and loving one another the way he did. We can honor him by imitating the smile that was always on his face. We can make the most of whatever time we have left on earth by loving God and loving one another. To imitate God's love is to be fully human, to live a full life. And in that love, we find comfort, hope, and peace for moving forward. My prayer this morning is for all of you to experience God's presence and love for you today and the days ahead as you remember with fondness our dear friend, our dear brother, our dear son, a remarkable young man, Kevi Kivalinks. God bless each one of you. Please join me as we close our time in prayer. Thank you, Jesus, for the privilege we all had in knowing and being impacted by the life of Matisse Kevi Kivalinks. Help us embrace that simple and pure faith in your Son, Jesus, trusting you without wavering as we look forward to the hope of eternal life. In your unconditional and unlimited love, comfort and empower each one of us in this time as we grieve and then move forward in life without Kevi by our side. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We'll listen to a closing song.